Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome to Manchester Art Gallery for our celebration of public transport policy. This is Bus Regulation the Musical. Hold on to your seats. Over the next 30 minutes, you'll be taken on a whistle-stop tour of more than 50 years of history. Please welcome your host for this afternoon, Dame Barbara Castle.
Hello, everybody. Hello, hello. Thank you. Thank you so much for coming today. For anyone who doesn't know me, I am indeed Dame Barbara Castle. I served in Clement Attlee's Labour government and then in opposition in the 1950s until we won power again in 1964. And then in 65, I became Transport Secretary, the only woman to have held that post in the 20th century. And that is, of course, why I am here with you today. Please welcome to the floor, Greater Manchester's bosses! In the 1960s, our city's buses were run by the region's 11 municipal bus companies, owned by each of our local authorities, or corporations, as they were known back then. They were Manchester, Salford, Bolton, Oldham, Stockport, Rochdale, Bury, Stalybridge, Hyde, Mossley and Dockingfield, or SHMD, alongside Lee, Ashton-under-Lyne and Ramsbottom, who sadly could not be here today. The 2,500 buses that had belonged to the 11 municipal bus companies came together to form Selnec's beautiful fleet. The first step was to standardise everything across the region by painting it all orange. Selnec's mission was to expand and improve that network, to coordinate and to integrate routes, timetables and, importantly, fares. They worked with British Rail to start improving the local rail network.
The Conservatives saw people who travelled by bus as failures in life. They were opposed to the public ownership and control of all services and infrastructure. They saw no benefits in coordination and integration, and they saw great dangers in public subsidy. Their aim was to centralise power in Westminster so they could force through their plans for privatisation. So they abolished the Greater Manchester Council in 1986. Their vision for public transport wouldn't require any strategic planning anyway. They thought the invisible hand of the market could do that work. Their 1985 Transport Act would deregulate bus operations everywhere in Britain, except London.
The 26th of October 1986 was known as D-Day, when deregulation came into effect. Suddenly, anyone who wanted to could start a bus company and operate whenever they thought they could make the most money. People bought up old buses wherever they could find them, and the vehicle quality deteriorated overnight. Parts of the city that had been served by buses since 1929 no longer had a service. The result was chaos. But in the 1990s, our bus services were about to go from bad to worse. There were now 68 operators in the Greater Manchester area, all with their own routes, their own timetables, and their own fares, which the travelling public had to try and make sense of. GM buses had to cut back even more in order to survive, closing four more depots and sacking yet more staff. So, in December 1993, GM Buses Limited was split to become GM Buses North and GM Buses South. Both companies were then sold to their employees in March 1994. The Conservatives claim that this would bring better services to passengers and reduce those fares. But the opposite proved true. In 1996, GM South was bought by the now not so little Scottish company Stagecoach. GM North was bought out by another little Scottish company based in Aberdeen called First. The bus wars began, with UK North running 30 buses an hour to take on Stagecoach's magic bus. They ended up gridlocking the city with traffic. They caused several nasty crashes, and one man was sadly killed. A later inquiry found that the driver involved in the crash had worked 19 days without a rest, and that 16 of their bus fleet were completely unroadworthy. UK North were clearly out of control. The traffic commissioner eventually intervened and shut them right down. That was the final straw. 22 years of deregulation had clearly been a race to the bottom. Politicians had finally begun to realise that this free market experiment had failed and more reform was on its way. In 2011, the Greater Manchester Combined Authority was established. Our passenger transport executive was given more new powers over traffic management and was rebranded again. Transport for Greater Manchester, with a new logo based on the emblem from 1974. It was also announced that Greater Manchester would also have its own mayor, who would be elected in 2017. But while we waited patiently for regulation, bus fares continued to rise and millions more miles of routes were cut. Bus passenger numbers had halved since deregulation in 1986. Then finally, in 2017, it looked like a positive change was finally on its way. Transport for Greater Manchester released their 20-year strategy with integration as its core principle, promising to deliver seamless journeys to the travelling public. And the new Bus Services Act offered new mayors, like Andy Burnham, the same powers as London to regulate their buses. Transport for Greater Manchester unveiled their plans to re-regulate all our region's buses as part of the Our Network scheme, going back to Cellnex's vision from the 1970s. Our Network plans to reshape the bus network so that it can again feed into and complement the railway and tramline so that the system works together as a whole. Sounds obvious? Yeah, you just make it seamless. Great, it's fine. We want it to be seamless. Every corner of the region. Re-regulating the buses as part of our network will mean that we can have one simple ticket to hop from bus to train to tram and only have to pay one daily price cap. Look at them go. This is something London has had since 2003 with its Oyster card. Deregulating has left the rest of Britain decades behind, and now it's time to catch up.